Hey everybody, and welcome you to the Hurdybird Internet Broadcast Network. And that's right, we do unique podcasts with Austin business owners and interest groups and associations, nonprofits. And tonight, Brian Henson, the pastor. We're going to talk to him a little bit how he got started. And we're just going to get to know him. We're going to take a snapshot of his life in the next 30 minutes. And he's going to catch us up a little bit what he's doing in Cedar Park. So Brian, welcome to the show.
Thanks so much, Hardy, for having me.
I'm going to take a short break, Brian. I've got this great sponsor who pays sponsorship for me to stay on the air with this show, right? We're going to let him do a little ad, and then we'll be right back.
Howdy, this is Todd Frank, owner of Jerry's Garage. We've been serving our customers since 1967. You know, vehicles have changed greatly over the years, but quality customer service and sound repairs have not. We've earned a great reputation with our clients. Check us out on Google and Yelp. So when you need repairs or maintenance on your gas or diesel vehicle, you'll call us. We work by appointment only and sometimes emergency. So our number is 512-255-7627. That number again, 512-255-7627. We look forward to earning your business at Jerry's Garage.
Okay, we're back. Brian, welcome to the show again. And, man, I am so glad I finally get to do this interview with you. I'm kind of excited, actually. You're in Cedar Park, and I guess we need to let everybody know, what is your vocation?
Yeah, I am actually I'm a church planter, and I'm secondarily, I'm also an emergency medical technician just for fun on the side. That's a pure hobby. I don't really do that much anymore. But my primary vocation here in Cedar Park is I am planting a church. So I'm starting a church from the ground up.
And they actually call that a church planter? Is that the actual term for the vocation?
Right.
That's pretty cool.
That's right. So that's the term that that most organizations use. And so even before that term was in vogue, probably within the last 30 years, that's really come into its own as being a term that churches often use. But that kind of thing has been getting done as long as there have been churches. So for 2,000 years, that's been happening. But that term, church planter, has probably been around in the church scene for probably about the last 30 years or so.
Yeah, I've heard the term. I just was curious if that was an actual vocation that somebody gets asked to go do, or is it kind of on the mission side, Brian? Is it kind of like a missionary thing, or is it
a
separate thing?
It is. No, that's a great way to think about it, actually. It is the same thing what we might think of as a missionary. It's the same exact thing.
Okay.
You're just typically – so. For instance, in the church planting network that I'm a part of, the Acts 29 church planting network, we have all over the globe, we have almost 700 churches now, and a lot of them are in America, but many of them are not. And
wow.
So a lot of the guys that are planting these churches, in kind of the more traditional categories we think of, we might think, well, that person is a missionary if they are in, say Yemen or Saudi Arabia planting a church. But they're doing the exact same work. It's church planting. It just depends upon where you're planting, whether it's domestic or international. But it's fundamentally the same thing.
All right. And so to step back a little bit, because we want to make sure we get a little bit of a story from you. Before you came here, what were you doing and where were you doing it?
Yeah, before we came, we've been here in Cedar Park for almost 3 years now. Before we came, I was the associate pastor at a church in the Memphis area. Actually, that it's called Collierville. It's the east side of Shelby County there in the Memphis metro area. I was the associate pastor at a church there called St. Patrick Presbyterian Church. And
awesome.
So when we moved here. We decided to call our church St. Patrick's, just St. Patrick Church. It's actually not a Presbyterian church. But we figured that the name would be one that that we would want to keep, and so that's the name of the work we're doing here. And like I said, we were in Memphis for 10 years, and absolutely loved it. Some of the best people we've ever met, and just a wonderful congregation there.
Transferred out of Memphis, you were there for a long time. You established yourself with your family, obviously, and friends. What got you guys to Cedar Park, Brian?
Well, we have been thinking for a while that we were maybe going to end up planting churches. I was actually blessed enough to work under a pastor in Memphis by the name of Jim Holland, who had planted two churches. He planted a church in the Mississippi Delta and then planted St. Patrick in Collierville. And so working under someone who had planted churches, that was kind of just something that I was always taught and schooled on. And then I eventually ended up for the denomination that I was ordained in, the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. I ended up being on the church planting committee with that local association of churches. And so I was busy putting guys into church planting, helping them be assessed and made sure that they were ready to go and plant a church. And the more we did that, the more that we thought that that was probably something that we were going to end up doing as well. And when we were here, actually, funny enough, we were right here locally in 2010. Jim and I came down here for a conference that was it's called the Verge Conference that Austin Stone Community Church puts on. And it was actually being hosted that year at Hill Country Bible Church here in Cedar Park, Austin mm-hmm. area. And at that conference, we really started to feel that God was probably calling us to plant a church. And so we continued to think about it, pray about it, talk to people who were older, wiser, who had been there and done that. And they thought that our particular gift set and experience and passion would probably serve us well in planting. So we started thinking, okay, what would this look like and where would it look like it? We knew that at some point we wanted to end up in Texas. My wife is from here, and if you know uh-huh. anything about Texas girls, they're always trying to get back to Texas eventually.
Absolutely.
And so her parents live down in the valley in McAllen, and uh-huh. so we knew that eventually that we would want to get much closer to them so they could enjoy their grandson more, since they had been 1,000 miles away from him for many years. And so Erica went to school here at the University of Texas, and
yep.
we had a lot of friends and ministry contacts. And so when we started looking at church planting, we knew it would probably be San Antonio or Austin, and the opportunities just presented themselves more in the Austin area. And we kind of, when we knew we were going to come here, we figured we would wind up somewhere in the suburbs for a couple of reasons. One, we actually love suburban type ministry, which is different from a center city type ministry, which is sure. valid and awesome, but it was not what we felt called to, particularly with 10 years of experience in the suburbs. And so we thought we would end up in the suburbs. And the other reason why we thought we'd end up in the suburbs, frankly, Hurdy, is that in Austin, Texas, you cannot afford a house anywhere in Austin. And so that kind of limited our options somewhat, but even yeah. all things being equal, we would have still been in the suburbs. And so at the recommendation of a friend named Will Walker, who is works with Acts 29 on a volunteer basis and is also the pastor of Providence Church in downtown Austin, he suggested that we check out Cedar Park. And so mm-hmm. when we came here, it was almost like, you know, the old Yogi Berra statement, deja vu all over again, because when we came, Cedar Park is almost the same population as Collierville. It's the same basic demographic as Collierville. It's a town with a lot of recent growth right on the edge of a more rural area, and that's exactly what Collierville was. And so when we came here, it was just an immediate fit. We had a sense that this is where we can really plug in. And it was a town that has something of a defined geography. So people that live sure. in Cedar Park, like, know they're in Cedar Park. And so in that sense, it's easy for people, for us to establish kind of a sense of place, that our church was going to minister primarily to this specific geography. and that's something awesome. People could get their heads around easily. So that was why we ended up in Cedar Park.
That's awesome. Great story. And so you had mentioned earlier, Brian, about what the vocations call. If you don't mind, could you elaborate a little bit? What does exactly a church planner do? What is his role? What is his what do you do every day? I guess I should ask it that way, right? What's your average day for a church planner?
Yeah, that's a good question. You're actually the second person in 2 days to ask me that question. My average day looks like, what I do a lot of as a church planter is actually relationship building. When we came here, we specifically came with the intention to go very slowly with this process and try to get to know people in the community before we started handing out business cards saying, hey, come to our church. And right. So we were here for a solid year before we did anything church related at all. We just tried to get to know the community and to know people, to make friendships, and really try to invest ourselves in Cedar Park. And so even now, that's a lot of what I do. And so I've had a friend of ours, a mutual friend, John Russell, here has called me he said, you know, you're like the Cedar Park business chaplain. And I don't know how true that is, but I do try to spend a lot of time with the business community, and that was not anything I'd really planned. It's just something that kind of happened through different relationships. I ended up being involved in the Cedar Park Chamber of Commerce, and then ended up getting in Leadership Cedar Park, which is a 9-month leadership program here in the city, and I office at a co-working facility here in Cedar Park called T-Works. And so through that, I interface on a daily basis with the other 60 business owners who have a presence there in T-Works. And so between those things and the networking events that I attend every week, I spend a lot of time just in relationship and in conversation with people. So that's a lot of it. A lot of it as well is administrative, because as an older church planter told me one time, he said, when you're planting the church, if you ain't doing it, it ain't happening. And so everything, like any small business owner, any entrepreneur on the front end of things, I basically do everything. So I'm, you know, making sure that even though we have an external bookkeeper, I have to talk to the bookkeeper. And we have an insurance agent, but I have to keep up with the insurance agent. So all of those things I generally do, which thankfully we've got several people in our group. Here in our local congregation, our core group, that have really stepped up and are starting to take some of those things over. But from starting off, I was doing most all of those things, with the exception of children's, working with the kids, which my wife does that, Erica, and she's fantastic. And then we have some friends, Jake and Megan, who lead our music. But outside of that, I was doing most of those things. And so I guess if you had to put it into buckets as a church planter, you would say you have an administrative bucket, you have a relationship bucket, and then you have the bucket of what you might consider traditionally as pastoral duties. So studying for and preparing Bible studies, writing material, making pastoral visits, things that are traditionally associated, and rightly so, traditionally associated with the role of a pastor. So those are the three main buckets, I guess, if you had to categorize everything that way.
When you're starting a church and you're going slowly, you would have to have some sort of outside support. Is this done by the other church planners that are established, or how does that work for you? What's difficult? What's hard?
Yeah, that's a good question, and I'm happy to answer it. The way that works, and the model, this what I'm about to describe will vary a bit from church to church. But generally speaking, this is kind of how it works in church planting. But specifically for us, what we did is after we had been here about a year established, my wife has a good job, thankfully. And so she had a vocation that she loves and is a real calling for her. And so that provided our first year a lot of our financial needs, that and the work I was doing as an EMT, and then also substitute teaching at a local private school. A lot, we're supplementing our income. And so after we'd been here about a year and had a very clear picture of what we were going to be doing, at that point we started doing external fundraising, meaning that we were talking to friends and churches, mostly in the Memphis area and in the Southeast, and some around the country that was saying, hey, this is what we're doing. This is what the financial need looks like over a three-year period. That's typically what church plants try to raise funds for, is a three-year window. And this is what we're trying to do. And is this something you'd be interested in financially supporting? And so through that, a lot of people said, yes, this is something that we want to do. So we have right now, we have three or four churches, established churches, that that actually support St. Patrick, and which is I receive a salary just like anybody else does. So all our money goes to is a St. Patrick account, and I get a W-2. We have an external board of directors and a bookkeeper, and so I'm not like running around with wads of cash in my pocket. And so we have churches that do that. We have churches that sponsor us, and then we have probably 20 individuals and families that do that all said, hey, we want to sponsor you guys for 3 years. And so we've been able to, just through different means, been able to, you know, really be very efficient with that money that has come in, such that it's provided us a real base to be able to do, not only provide for my salary, but also just the normal day-to-day stuff. You have a ministry, getting copies made, buying ink for the printer, you know, hosting events, things like that. So that's generally speaking how it works. And one of the neat things of the church planting network that we're with, and again, it's Acts 29 Church Planting Network, and I think it's the website is acts29network.org. You can find out more about our family of churches. But one of the neat things that we do is our motto is Acts 29. It's actually very simple. It's just churches planting churches, three words. That's it, churches planting churches. And so our goal as churches is how do we, once we are established as a church, how do we plant more churches? So 10% of everything that we raise from within the church. So now I'm talking about money that people who are currently in our congregation give on a weekly or monthly or semi-monthly basis. 10% of that money that's given actually is designated for church planting, for future church planting. So it's kind of a self-perpetuating thing. So let's say, for instance, let's say we had some gazillionaire from Westlake started coming to St. Patrick, and he said, you know what, I'm going to give $1 million this year. I'm going to give $1 million offering this year to St. Patrick, which, by the way, if you're out there listening to this, Westlake millionaire, give me a call. We'll talk. But let's say that somebody said they're going to give $1 million. So for that year, let's say we took in $1.1 million from the entire congregation. So a tenth of that, so $110,000, would be designated and earmarked for nothing but church planting.
That's awesome.
So churches that are not called St. Patrick churches, so money that we are giving to other churches to plant churches.
That's awesome.
And so that's what that's one of the things that that's one of the reasons we're part of Acts 29. It's because we believe so strongly in the philosophy of ministry and in this kind of self-perpetuating nature that it's we're always looking for ways to get the next church planted. So I mean, from the day we had our very first Bible study here at St. Patrick, I think the very first night, November 1st of 2015, we had a Bible study. I talked to that group that night about, what are we going to, like, how are we going to plant the next church? So I'm already thinking about how would St. Patrick plant another church down the road. So it's always in front of us. You know, probably the most difficult thing, Herdy, in all of it is the pace. And what I mean by that is that, you know, pastors have egos just like everybody else. And you tend to think, you know, sadly, in terms of, you know, thinking about numbers, you know, how many people do we have? And God has done a really good job of reminding me that in the Great Commission, so Matthew 28, shortly before Jesus ascended back to heaven, he told his followers, he said, go and make disciples. He didn't say go and plant churches and get gigantic groups. And so making disciples, like so, and Alan Hirsch, who is a theologian, said one time, that if you just plant churches and that's all you're worried about, if you just plant churches, you might get disciples. You might get people who really follow Jesus. But if you make disciples, you will guarantee get churches. Like you will, and so that's something that that I have to remind myself of a lot, because the pace is slow enough that, I mean, I can look. I was talking to Erica about this earlier today. In fact, I can look and say, okay, do we have a ton of people right now? No. And that frustrates the fire out of me as somebody who likes to kind of go, go, go. But when I look at, okay, are disciples being made? In other words, are people really starting to follow Jesus at a deeper level? By God's grace, the answer to that question has been a resounding yes.
I don't know really how to ask the question. I guess just where do you see yourself at St. Patrick's in 5 years? Maybe that's the best way to ask it.
Sure, sure. We set goals in similar ways to business people. A lot of times we try to do what smart business people do also. We try to hold those things with an open hand, realizing that, you know, different circumstances, things can speed up or slow down in ways you didn't anticipate. But we are, you know, by God's grace, Lord willing, what I'd love to see in 5 years is that we are a, you know, vibrant, and what I mean by vibrant is that people are actually coming to love Jesus and other people more. Mm-hmm. That we are a congregation that is doing that. One of our taglines around here has always been that we exist to make Jesus famous and to help other people find their hope and joy in Him. Awesome. And so, if in 5 years we're doing that, and we have you know, folks in our church really are owning that and telling other people about it. If we're doing that, and if we are, and if we are down the road toward planting another church, that is what I'm hoping and praying. And so when I say we, I don't mean me and Eric are going to plant that church. I mean that we are cultivating leaders to go and plant that next church, and just in general having a strong leadership culture where folks really feel like, hey, I'm able to move the ball down the field. And able to carry the DNA of St. Patrick with us, you know, if we have a young couple that God calls to another area to plant a church, that they could go and replicate at least the parts that are worth replicating in another area. So that's what we hope to be.
All right. So before we get into your hobbies and fun stuff you love to do, can you tell me where Bubba came from?
Yeah. So people call me Bubba here because most of the people here found out about it because of my email address, which has that word in it. But that word came from when I was in college at Murray State in Kentucky. There was a group of guys on campus that it was kind of it wasn't an official like Greek system fraternity. It wasn't part of the Panhellenic Council or anything like that. But but it was essentially that. People knew us as that. We had a house and those sorts of things, and people called us. We had a more official title, but people called us the Bubba guys. And believe it or not, that was actually named from a very cheap cola product that the Save-A-Lot grocery stores used Bubba. To sell. Maybe they still sell it. It was called Bubba Cola, and we used to always keep coolers stocked with Bubba Cola. People started calling us the Bubba guys. And so anyway, all these years later, everybody in Cedar Park calls me Bubba. That's it.
I love it. Well, see, you knew I had to bring it up. I wasn't going to let the same questions go by without saying, hello, little Bubba.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
I call you Brian because that's how I know you. But
sure.
I
you're
like
one
Bubba
of the few.
Too, you know, either one you turn your head on. So that's cool. Okay.
That's right.
Hobbies. What do you like to do now? Before you get into your hobbies, you had mentioned earlier EMT. Is that something you're still licensed, certified to do? You can crawl on.
I am still licensed to do that. I actually am officially on the payroll of a local EMS company still, just as a you know, as needed employee. But I haven't been doing it recently. I haven't been doing it recently simply because of the pace of things around here with the church. But I've done that. Okay, amount since we've been here in Austin, and just to enjoy that. Most of my family or a lot of my family is involved in medicine on one level or another. And so in another life, had I not been a pastor, I'd have been a doctor. So it's kind of a way to scratch my medical itch and still be a pastor.
Still helping people out one way or the other, right? That's good.
That's right.
Okay, hobby-wise, what do you like to do when you're not outpacing yourself?
I love to read. I love to read all kinds of stuff, biographies, fiction, a lot of history. And I also, probably my main hobby is actually smoking meat. I do a lot of, I have three.
You love the barbecue. That's something we can talk about. Yeah.
Yeah. I've got a couple of smokers and got some grills and competed in a couple of barbecue competitions here in Cedar Park. And I do big cookings for groups sometimes when they need it, Cub Scouts, whatnot. And so I love to smoke meat. That's probably my main hobby.
That's awesome.
Awesome. Yeah,
and fun. Book, and when will the book be out on how to barbecue? Have you written it yet for us? Or,
I tell you, Craig Goldwyn and Aaron Franklin, those two guys both beat me to the punch. So just go read their books.
Go. All right. Okay, cool. So that's cool. And what a nice hobby to have. I mean,
yes.
You get to eat great whatever. You're cooking brisket or whatever, right? Doesn't matter.
Yep.
I mean, good grief. So how many grills do you actually have?
Okay, I have three. Okay, all three of my devices can be used as grills or smokers. Yes, my wife has told me that I can't have another one unless there's one certain kind of Weber that's gigantic, and she told me I could have that if I could find it. But other than that, I the kibosh is on me for grills. I got to get a bigger yard if I want to get more grills.
One thing we did not talk about, and that's our last question: where did that name come from, and why are you called St. Patrick?
Short answer is that our Catholic friends shouldn't get to have all the good church names, as my mentor Jim Holland once said. But here's the actual reason why we knew we always wanted to call it St. Patrick, aside from it being kind of an homage to our church in Memphis. But Patrick of Ireland is truly one of the most fascinating characters and important characters in the history of the church. Grew up in Britain, so he was actually not Irish. He was from Britannia, as it would have been known in those days in the late Roman Empire. And so when he was a young man, he grew up in a Christian home. His dad was a deacon in the church, very powerful locally. His grandfather, I believe, had also been a churchman of some kind. So when he was a young man, he was actually kidnapped by Irish pirates and taken to Ireland. Now, what was interesting is even though he grew up in the church, he had never really cared much about Christianity at all. But you can imagine how being kidnapped by Irish pirates might make you rethink your metaphysical assumptions. And so so while he was there, he was actually the slave of a village chieftain who employed him, who had him work as a shepherd. So while he was there spending all this time in the field watching sheep, he really started to take his faith very seriously. He came to know Jesus and really became very devout in his faith, not knowing whether he would ever see home again or not. And you got to remember at this point, Ireland is such a crazy place that even Rome never tried to invade Ireland because they saw a group of people who were barbarians who would strip naked and paint themselves blue and spike their hair and go kill each other. And these people were crazy. And so Rome never even tried to touch them. So Patrick is in this just crazy land that's rife with war, bloodshed, and paganism. They worshiped all kinds of gods, and it was just a crazy place. Well, so anyway, one night while he's out in the field praying, he has this vision. Now, this is really largely according to his autobiography, which is known as his Confessions. And you can get the fuller story of this in a book called How the Irish Saved Civilization by Thomas Cahill. Patrick was in this field. He sees this vision where basically an angel says to him, Patrick, go to the coast. You'll find your way home there. And so he walks to the eastern coast of Ireland and undetected gets there. There's a ship that's actually a trading ship that's heading back to England. And so he says, hey, can I barter passage back? They tell him no. He starts to walk away, and as he's walking away, he prays that God would give him favor with the ship's captain. Shortly thereafter, the captain hollers at him, hey, kid, come on, get on board. So he gets home to England, ends up settling down, gets a theological education, becomes a pastor, and is doing fine into his 40s, from what we can tell, probably mid-40s. And one night he has a dream, much like a dream that the Apostle Paul had in the book of Acts, where there are some Irish people who are saying to him in the dream, Patrick, come back, to Ireland, walk among us again, and basically come and tell us about this God that you worship. And so he goes and approaches the church authorities that were over him, and they essentially said, not in exactly these words, but essentially said, Patrick, absolutely not. If God wants to save those people, he'll do it himself. Though those are crazy people, they are beyond the pale of God's salvation. And so Patrick said, well, guess what? I'm going to go anyway. And so he took a chalice, a cup to do communion, and what scriptures he had, and a cross, and a group of friends, and they went to Ireland. And when he arrived, he would talk to a village chieftain and say, hey, can I talk to you about this God that I worship? And sometimes they would say yes. Sometimes they would say no. And if they would say no, he'd say, well, look, can I just be useful then around the community? Can we kind of move on the outskirts of town, set up camp, and we just want to be useful and helpful? Because you got to remember, Patrick knew the culture, and he knew the language, which was a huge benefit. And so, again, one of the reasons why when we came here, we were here for a year so that we could learn the culture and the language before we started doing anything else. And so we were taking a page out of Patrick's book. And so eventually Patrick would win the right to share the gospel of Jesus with these different villages. And he was very clear on the gospel, what Jesus came and did in his life, death, and resurrection. Mm-hmm. And he was very big on teaching about the Trinity, which he never used like a three-leaf clover to talk about the Trinity. That's kind of a myth. And he also didn't chase all the snakes out of Ireland. That's also a myth. But he did teach a lot about, taught a lot about the Trinity. And so through his work and the work of his colleagues, 800 churches were planted in Ireland during his lifetime. Wow. And the island was converted to Christianity without bloodshed, amazingly. And not only were people coming to know Jesus, but he was teaching them how to read and write, because he wanted them to be able to read the scriptures. And so as that happened, these scriptoriums started to pop up. And so people were in these scriptoriums, men were learning to read, write, and then write the scriptures, make copies of the scriptures. And so they start copying. Well, in the meantime, across the channel on the continent, Rome is burning, literally. Like by this point, the barbarians have taken over Roman Empire, laid waste to it. And when they did that, not only were they laying waste to the cities, but they were particularly laying waste to the libraries. And so they were burning all of the classics of antiquity with that. And in the midst of all of this, some people started hearing about this far-flung land of Ireland where there were scriptoriums. And so they start smuggling the classics of antiquity into Ireland. So Plato, Aristotle, Cicero, you name it, they're making it to Ireland. And these monks, along with copying the scriptures, are copying those works. And after all the dust settles and the smoke clears on the continent, Irish missionaries, homegrown Irish missionaries, begin to take both the gospel and classical Western culture back to the continent of Europe. And so that title of Cahill's book that I mentioned recently, How the Irish Saved Civilization, that's not a far-flung statement. They really did save at least Western civilization, and really provided sort of the principle for much of Christianity, not all of Christianity, but because there were Christians in Africa and in the East. But in the West, it was so powerful what Patrick and the Irish did. And so as we looked at the way that he presented the gospel, the way that he ministered to these communities, we said, you know, that's something that we want a part of and we want to emulate. And that's how St. Patrick in Collierville was started. That was Jim Holland. That was the same vision he had for the church there. In fact, he has a son named Patrick because of that. And so as we learn more of that story, we said, if we ever plant a church, we're calling it St. Patrick for the exact same reason. So that's why it's St. Patrick. There you go. St. Patrick Church.
We just finished up, and I want to thank Brian, or you can call him Bubba, whatever you want. But one thing I do want to make sure we have a way to contact you, because Brian, on the player, I'm going to have contact information. So if somebody hears this on demand as it's being shared out there and wants to find you, what's the best way to get a hold of you?
Yeah, the best way to contact me directly is you can actually send an email. to Brian, B-R-I-A-N, at stpatrick, so stpatrickchurch.net. So Brian at stpatrickchurch.net. And you can also, our website is www.stpatrickchurch.net, and our Facebook is facebook.com/stpatrick, which is, again, stpatrick, CP, so St. Patrick Cedar Park. And any of those ways are easy ways to find out what's going on at the church and to be able to contact me directly.
And would you do me a favor, make sure you email those links to me so I can put them in the player, if that's okay. That way I won't have to do it from memory, which is not really good. You really want to send them to me?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right, Brian, thank you for being on the Herdy Burke Broadcast Network. I always enjoy these interviews because I've probably done 160 of these, right? And every time I do it, I learn something new about the people I'm around and get to know. And I just want to tell you, I really appreciate you, and thanks for sharing your story. It's been awesome.
Actually, Herdy, I appreciate the opportunity, man. Sure enough, and I will see you soon, I'm sure.
That's right. And you guys have been listening to the Herdy Burke Internet Broadcast Network. We take care of Austin business here, and we interest groups and people like Brian that are pastors that are planning a church. We love to talk to people. This, we'll see you guys around the corner in a couple of weeks. There'll be another nice podcast up for you to listen to. But you guys have a great evening. Brian, thank you again, and good night, everybody.